Today is the 10th day of the first month on Yahweh's restored calendar. This 10th day is the day that he commanded us to set aside the Passover lamb or goat each year for the memorial of his Passover that he offers to us. It is also the anniversary of the day that our Messiah rode into Jerusalem on the ass's colt. The 10th day is also significant in Yahweh's calendar in other months with events that are important in his plan to build his eternal family. The 10th day of the second month is the day that he told Noah to start loading the ark. The 10th day of the 7th month is his commanded observance of the Day of Atonement. In this video, I will also discuss why our Creator has funneled the end of man's 6,000-year error into the 8th day of the 11th month like he has. He has revealed his end-time timeline in a systematic manner that has brilliantly testified to why he is sending his wrath and to whom he is sending it upon. His doing so has also testified to his word in a magnificent way. And his doing so has testified to his love for his creation and to his desire for us to become his eternal children and to his long-suffering that he has endured as he has built his first fruits from our midst. He led me to start sounding the shofars on the first day of the 10th month this past year. This day was the anniversary of Noah seeing the tops of the mountains. It fell on the 19th day of December on the calendar that Satan gave to his children. The first day of the 11th month this year will be on January 13th, 7 days before January 20th of next year on Satan's calendar. This first day of the 11th month will be 390 days or 13 30-day months from the first day of the shofars beginning to sound on December 19th. Noah's 377-day timeline is 13 days short of 390 days. The reason why these 390 days is significant is Peter asked Yeshua how many times he should forgive a brother who has sinned against him, and Yeshua said, "I say to you, until not seven, but until 70 times seven." 70 times 7 equals 490. Yeshua, like he often did other times, seized the opportunity to give a parable and an end-time prophecy in his answer to Peter. Notice his emphasis on not 7 here in his answer to Peter. I pointed out that 390 days from the beginning of the first shofar lands on day 1 of the 7 days leading up to the 8th day of the 11th month. If you think that Yeshua's reference to not 7 here in this verse is just a random example that he used, you are being willfully ignorant. Everything that is recorded that he spoke has significance. He was giving a prophecy that there would come a point in time when our Elohim's letting man continue in their rebellion to him would come to an end and his time of tribulation would be sent upon them. And he referenced the number 490 in this prophecy for a reason. Noah was told to start building the ark 490 years after the year 1100 from when Yahweh placed man in the garden. Yahweh bid him to start building the ark in the year 1590. Another 490-year period of time is found in Daniel's 70 weeks prophecy that is recorded in chapter 9 that testifies to Yeshua being our Messiah. This 490-year period began in the year 3300. I want to point out that the year 3300 is yet another tie-in to the 330 days in Noah's 377-day timeline. In Daniel 9:24, we read this prophecy, 70 weeks and 70 times 7 days equals 490 days, which is prophetic for 490 years, are decreed to your people and to the holy city to turn from your rebellion so that you can be forgiven, and to end your transgressions so that you can be forgiven, and to cancel your evil perversions so that you can be forgiven, and to come to everlasting righteousness, and to seal up this vision and this prophecy, and to anoint the holy, holy. So you see, Yeshua's reference to forgiving 490 times is indeed significant. Our Creator's timeline testifies to his desire to forgive us, but his word says that we must turn from our rebellion to him and put an end to our evil perversions of his word. There are also other 490-year tie-ins in with the other 1,100-year breaks in this 6,000-year era of time. And the 1,100-year breaks are prophetic for Yahweh putting an end to man's error in the 11th month as well. I have discussed these 1,100-year periods in other videos. 390 days of the 490 days of Yeshua's parable for how long man should be forgiven leads up to January 13th. I will explain the other 100 days. The numbers in the prophecy that Yehua has sent me to you with are all recorded in His Word. And several of them are recorded in the measurements that He gave to Ezekiel for His temple. Within these measurements, there is even a reference to this 100-day period of time in the form of 100 cubits. This reference is found in Ezekiel 41:15. And He measured the length of the building upon the face of the separate place, which was behind it, and to the galleries, referring to an offset, to the offsets in a building, on this side and on the other side, 100 cubits, with the interior of the temple and the porches of the court. This is a prophecy that the 100 days would be offset, here a little, there a little, measuring line upon measuring line, precept upon precept. 40 days before December 19th was November 9th. This is 40 days of the 100 days. This 40-day period has been discussed in other videos as well. November 9th was the day that Yahweh funneled His timeline into to stamp His judgment on the 10 tribes of Israel that He placed under Jeroboam's care. He used Jeroboam's profaning of His Feast of Temporary Dwellings in the 8th month to illustrate this judgment. I'll share with you yet another, as it was in the days of Noah match. The first fruit harvest on July 19th was 113 days prior to November 9th. In the 377-day Noah code, there were 106 days between when Noah let loose the first dove and when Yahweh allowed for him and his family to come off the ark. Following this prophecy through, here a little, there a little, there were 7 days from when Yahweh told him to start loading the ark until he closed the door. This totals 113 days. This 7 days being separate from Noah's time on the ark is a prophecy that apart from that part of the 490 days is going to be separated off from the rest of them. And the 7 days happened before the first fruit harvest, what it's symbolic of. I'll expand on this a bit and what it's a prophecy to, how it ties into a 10-day prophecy for the 10 days. 50 days prior to November 9th was the first day of the 7th month on Yahweh's restored calendar. This day is His commanded observance of the Memorial of Acclamations that most people erroneously call the Feast of Trumpets. This totals 90 of the 100 days, and these 90 days are a continuance of the 390, and the 90 has some symbolism in it as well that I'll get to in a bit. At this point in time, we were 480 days out from day one of the 7 days that take us up to the 8th day of the 11th month. This means that on the Memorial of Acclamations that landed on last September 20th, that at this time we were 487 days out from the 8th day itself, since the 7 days that begin on the 13th would be counted in from that way of looking at it. However, they're not counted in the 490 days, and I'll explain this as well as we go on. The 10 days are separated off, and Yahweh did this to put the emphasis on the 10th day. I will point out, though, that in this 487 days, there is yet another 110-day match to Noah's timeline. 487 minus Noah's 377 days is another 110-day match to go along with the several others that have already been revealed. And the 110-day matches are also given to testify to the 11th month and even to the 10th day, since 110 is 11 times 10s or 11 10s or 10 11s, however you want to look at it. There's even another 330-day mirror in this as well. 330 days is 11 30-day months. 330 days prior to January 13th was the 17th day of the second month on man's calendar. So there's a mirror there. And it was on the 17th day of the second month on Yahweh's calendar that He closed the ark's door behind Noah and his family. The way that He keeps mirroring and matching His timeline into Noah's 377-day account is phenomenal. Even within the 330 days is 655s, and 55 represents His Isaiah 55:11 signature ring that He sent me with. And 6 represents the 6 stone pots that our Messiah used for a vehicle to turn the water into wine. And all of the references of 6 are symbolic of the 6,000 years of man's error as well. it's coming to an end. And this 11th month or 330-day, 11-month or 330-day period between the 17th day of the second month and the 13th day of January, which is the first day of the 11th month on Yehshua's restored calendar, is being given to point us to the 11th month as well. Here is another place that we find a reason why Yehua is funneling his wrath into the 11th month, found in Deuteronomy 1. These are the words that Moses spoke to all of Israel on this side of the Jordan, in the wilderness and in the desert towards the Red Sea, between Paran and Tophel and Laban and Hazeroth and Dizahab. There are 11 days, or 10 and 1, journey from Horeb by the way of Mount Seir to Kadesh Barnea. And it came to pass in the 40th year, in the 11th month, on the first day of the month, that Moses spoke to the children of Israel all that Yahweh had commanded unto them. In lieu of these verses, and in lieu of what the Isaiah 55:11 signature ring that Yahweh placed on my hand testifies to, if you think that this signature ring could possibly be my own manifestation, you are delusional. This signature ring ties in why he gave us his word and why he created us in with the entire witness that his word testifies to, that his two witnesses were to be set with. Yeshua also gave a parable that was also a prophecy for the 11th month that also ties in our Creator's desire to forgive us. He said in Matthew 20, verse 6, "And about the 11th hour he went out and found others standing idle and said to them, 'Why do you stand here all day idle?'" In this parable, he broke up the day into quarters with his illustration of hiring others in the third hour and the sixth hour and the ninth hour. But he used those who he hired in the 11th hour to make his point. They had only worked 1 hour, yet the goodness of the master that hired them was revealed. He paid them the same wages as he gave to those who worked all day. But these servants still had to work, just like you still need to turn from your rebellion in order to be forgiven. You have to bring forth fruit worthy of his forgiveness, and this fruit is genuine repentance. This parable is a prophecy not only of Yahweh's goodness, it is also a prophecy for those of you who will repent in the 11th month. Repentance is turning from your rebellion to the Most High. If you do, he will deliver you into the millennium, where you will become the planting thereof, where you can become part of the latter harvest into his eternal family. Even Yeshua's reference to 1 hour here ties in this prophecy with the coming time of a judgment, ties it into Revelation chapter 18, standing afar off for the fear of her torment, saying, "Alas, alas, the great city Babylon, that mighty city, because in 1 hour your judgment is come, because in 1 hour so great riches, your great riches has come to nothing. And every shipmaster and all the company in the ships and sailors and as many as trade by the sea stood afar off. And they cast dust on their heads and cried, and weeping and wailing, saying, 'Alas, alas, the great city wherein were made rich all that had ships in the sea by reason of her costliness, because in 1 hour she is made desolate.'" And this 1 hour is the 11th hour, and the 11th hour is symbolic of the 11th month. Here is another reference to the 11th month that contains symbolism that applies to this coming 11th month. Found in 1 Chronicles chapter 27, verse 14, the 11th captain for the 11th month was Benaiah, the Parathonite of the children of Ephraim, and in his course were 24,000. Benaiah means Yahweh builds or Yahweh restores, and Parathonite comes from a word that means to avenge. Now I will explain to you why the 8th day of the 11th month. The 8th day is always the first Sabbath rest of each new month. It is on the 8th day of a male's life that he is supposed to be circumcised. It is on the 8th day from the first day of when the blood departs from a woman that she is pronounced clean. It is the 8th day following the first day of the 7-day Feast of Temporary Dwellings that is the High Sabbath that is symbolic of the Great White Throne of Judgment that follows our Creator's 7,000-year plan to build his eternal family. And it was in the 8th month that Jeroboam profaned Yahweh's 7th month feast. And it was the anniversary of the last day of Jeroboam's feast that Yahweh used to stamp, for an example of why a double portion of his wrath is being sent upon the scattered nations of Israel that have polluted or rejected his appointed times. It is indeed fitting that he has funneled his prophecies into the 8th day of the 11th month the way that he has. But don't wait for the 11th hour for you to cause you to turn from your rebellion to him. If your heart is to do so, chances are your heart won't make this choice anyway. I have asked several times in these videos, why do you need for him to humble you into hearkening to him? Why not just obey him because you love him and you want to walk with him in agreement with his righteousness so that you will be found in his favor? I will tell you why not. It is because nearly all of you do not love his righteousness. You are in love with an image of him that you got from your father the devil. His righteousness has no place in your rebellious, uncircumcised hearts. And you are soon to have his wrath unleashed upon you just to get 3.3333% of you to turn from your rebellion to his true image and to his word, therefore to his son. It is indeed a sad state of affairs that you are this stiff-necked and rebellious, but it is what it is, just like his word says that it would be this way at the time of the end. And now dying, you will soon die if you do not turn from your rebellion to him. I began this video saying that today, the 10th day of the first month, is the day that he commanded us to set aside the lamb or the goat for the Passover memorial. If you are refusing to obey that which his word tells us we must do, if you think that his Passover sacrifice of his son's shed blood is being applied on your behalf, you are sorely deceived. His word commands us to celebrate the Passover each year per the instructions that he gave to us in his word, as a memorial of his Passover sacrifice to us. Plus, if you are living in rebellion to Yehshua's word, then his Passover sacrifice of his son's shed blood is not being applied to your transgressions anyway. His son told us that the first step is for us to turn from our rebellion to his father's word, repent. Then the water that we are baptized under is turned into his shed blood to atone for our past transgressions of his father's word. I mentioned the three primary tears of the 10th day of the month. The first was Noah being told to load the ark on the 10th day of the second month. This is significant to Yahweh's backup Passover opportunity in the second month that I will get to in a minute. Noah loaded the ark for 6 of the 7 days because the 15th day was the Sabbath, so he would have rested on that day. And again, the 6 is a reference to the 6,000 years of man's era of time under the tutelage of Satan for those who rejected Yahweh's tutelage. And of course, this 6,000 years is about to come to an end. It was cut short anyhow. It's being cut short. I've spoken about that in other videos. Like our Messiah prophesied, it would be cut short. This tier of the 10th day also represents that you must turn to having a heart like Noah's hearts and the rest of the patriarchs' hearts if you're going to be spared from Yahweh's coming wrath and delivered into the millennium. The next tier of the 10th day is his two-step atonement process that is outlined in his instructions for the Day of Atonement on the 10th day of the 7th month. This two-step process is discussed in parts 2 and 3 of the 7th month High Day videos. I'll put the link to these videos in the video description box below as well. The third tier of the 10th day is Yahweh's command for us to set aside the lamb or goat on this day for his Passover memorial on the 14th. And of course, the 10th day is also reflective of it being the anniversary of Yeshua riding into Jerusalem on this day. Chances are, if you are listening to this video today, you have not made preparations to set aside the Passover on this day today. Plus, the magnification of the dead person statute says that if you are not walking in our Messiah's footsteps, who lived by his father's every word, therefore living by his father's every word like he did, you are unclean like a dead person is. Therefore, you would have to first turn from your rebellion and start following in our Messiah's footsteps in order to be clean. Then you would need to be cleansed for 7 days with the water of separation in the red heifer statute before you could observe the Passover anyway. And the Passover is in 4 days, so this would not work out for you. But there is good news for you. The good news for you is Yahweh has a backup provision in place for you to do so, to observe his Passover, and to set aside the Passover lamb and goat on the 10th day of the second month. This day will fall on the 27th of April on Satan's calendar. And the 14th, where the actual backup Passover would fall on the first day, I believe, of May. I need to figure that out, if there's 30 or 31 days in April. I didn't look before doing this video. I think it's May 1st. I'll put the links for the Passover and the backup Passover videos in the description box as well. In Numbers 9, we read about this backup Passover opportunity, verse 6. And there were men who were individuals with defiled bodies or unclean bodies, so they could not observe the Passover on the day that they, and on that day, and they came before Moses and before Aaron on that day. The King James translated this that they were defiled because they had touched dead bodies, but the word for dead is not in the original text in the Hebrew. It's added. This word is telling us that these individuals who were unclean for whatever reason, this certainly could include touching a dead body or even actually being a dead body per the magnification of the dead person statute, or could be other things that his word tells us makes us unclean. These physical statutes are given to teach us to fight to remain pure and on the path of to perfection and clean before our Elohim's face. Verse 7, and those men said to him, what shall those of us who are among the children of Israel who have unclean bodies do, since we are withheld from drawing near to Yahweh's offering at his appointed time? And Moses said to them, stand still, and I will hear what Yahweh will command concerning you. And Yahweh spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel, saying, if any man of you or of your dwelling has an unclean body, or be in a journey afar off, he is still to observe Yahweh's Passover. The 14th day of the second month, at evening, they shall prepare it, and eat it bitter with unleavened bread. They shall leave none of it until the morning, nor break any bone of it. According to all of the ordinances of the Passover, they shall accomplish it. But the man that is clean and is not in a journey, and forbears to keep the Passover, even the same life shall be cut off from among his people, because he did not draw near to Yahweh's offering on his appointed time. And that man shall bear his sin. And if a stranger shall sojourn among you and observe Yahweh's Passover according to the ordinance of the Passover and according to the manner thereof, so shall he do. You shall have one ordinance, both for the stranger and for him that was born in the land. Of course, the stranger would have to be clean as well. And now that the dead person statute has been magnified, they would need to be following in our Messiah's footsteps as well in order to be clean. I pointed out earlier that 480 days of the 490-day prophecy are from the Memorial of Acclamations this past year to the beginning of the 7 days that lead up to the 8th day of the 11th month. I also showed you where Yahweh's word testifies that part of the first 100 days of the 490 would be offset. His word declares that only a tithe of a third will be brought to repentance through the coming calamity. A tithe is 10%. 10% of 100 is 10 days. He offset these 10 days to emphasize the importance of the 10th day of the first and the second and the seventh months. Notice that there are three tiers to these 10 days. 10th days. He also did so to emphasize the importance of the two 90-day periods on each side of the scattering of my hair last July per the Ezekiel 5 prophecy. The 90-day periods testified to his restoration of the 30-day months, and they were bookends to the last days of each of his 7-day feast, the spring feast and the fall harvest feast. And the first 10 days of the 490-day count were referring to a particular 10-day period. Our Messiah prophesied about this 10-day period in Revelation chapter 2. And to the angel of the called out ones of Smyrna write, these things saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. I know your affliction and poverty, but you are rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. Fear none of these things which you will suffer. Behold, the devil will cast some of you into prison, that you may be tried, and you will have affliction 10 days. Be faithful to death, in other words, conquer and trust and obey, and I will give you the crown of life. On April 3rd of last year, I posted a video called 10 Days in Prison that separated out a particular 10-day period. April 3rd was the 11th day of the first month on Yahweh's calendar. This was the day after the 10th day of the month when we are commanded to set aside the Passover lamb or goat, as you can hear in the background there. And this particular 10th day was the last day of this tier of Yeshua's 10-day prophecy. The theme of this video was about how Yehua's timeline unfolding like it had at that time caused some to be put in prison by Satan. The video discussed the testing and the refining process that Yehua has put in front of those whom he is calling to become his eternal children. It was about how this process demands that we trust and obey him. And since this time, he has continued to reveal his timeline in a systematic way, here a little, there a little. And his doing so has continued to be a witness against those of you who refuse to trust and obey him and hearken to what his word is testifying to. It was 10 days ago that I posted the last video that I posted, a video called Noah Remove the Covering. These past 10 days were a mirror to the 10 days last year. In this video, I read in Exodus 40, and Yehua spoke to Moses saying, "You shall rise up the dwelling of the tabernacle of the appointed times on the first day of the first month." Yehua is telling you that if you want for him to deliver you through what is about to come upon you, you're going to have to return to his appointed times, including his restored Sabbath, and hearkening to his Passover memorial and to his other appointed times. He is getting ready to show you that you are not covered by him. The covering has been removed, and the shame of your nakedness is about to be revealed. And he is preparing to purge his sanctuary. The 10 days in Yeshua's prophecy is about what the 10-day in prison video testified to. I will put the link to this video in the description box as well. The point of what this 10 days testified to is that nearly all of you do not fully put your trust in Yehua's word. His word is not your measuring rod, and his son was made to be his word in the flesh. Therefore, you do not fully put your trust in the true image of his son. And this is why his son's prophetic 490 days of having his blood available to you to atone for your sins is about up. Thus saith Yehua Elohim.